you waive that?
Huh?
Can't you waive it?
Can't you waive what?
Whatever fee or whatever.
You can do all of those different things. I'm just saying that a lot of what I've been seeing, my experience, because like I tell everybody from the beginning, you know, I do this every day off of experience. When we're off of experience, you can say and do whatever is necessary. You know what I mean? That you need to do to protect yourself legally based on the argument you're making. But it's always going to come down to they got the guns right now in that position. That's just how I've been able to see it. You know what I mean? That's at the bottom line of it. Now, because you're in a war type situation, you know, well, it's not type of situation, it's actually a war. It's about countering. Just like in any fight, in boxing, there's a counter. For every punch, you got to duck, throw another punch. You know what I mean? You got to plan and strategize to see how you're going to attack the enemy. You know what I mean? So the strategy is very important in any kind of legal situation. You know, you hear attorneys and all that get together and talk about how they want to prepare some kind of legal strategy.
Brother Shahab, you just mentioned a great point about putting the lien against the municipality. I believe you're talking about either a warranty lien or a mechanics lien, if I'm
right,
mistaken.
Right.
You know, there's a common law lien, you can do that also.
Mm-hmm.
That's a beautiful tactic in that when you put that lien against that municipality, they now can't issue bonds, get credit, and get financing with respect to the municipality. So you literally are shutting down business at that point, okay? And then the only way that can be exhausted and released is by the individual with that lien. So they really have to deal with the matter at that point, and you really are affecting them in the peace.
But that also has to be done properly.
Right, it has to be done properly. But it also is just one of the different things you should focus on other than, you know, really utilizing. When you're dealing with, like Brother Ty was saying, when you're dealing with the municipals, when you say the Constitution, that really gets them, they get alert then. They really do. I don't care what it is, what kind of situation. If you say something about my constitutional rights are being violated, put that on the record, then they start to slow their speed down a little bit. You know what I mean? That's actually what Brother Colonel did. He was saying that his constitutional rights are being violated and that he's already notified the provost marshal because I did through, you know, documentation, different things like that. You know what I mean? I actually got an email back from that department, not from the provost marshal, but I got an email back from, you know, there's a lot of specifics of how you even got to contact the right provost marshal. Because they got provost marshals, but then there's provost marshals specifically for certain issues that's pertaining to constitutional rights violations. And they really slowed their speed up. They slowed it up.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
I was going to wait until after y'all ask the questions. But even in New York, dealing with the provost marshals, it's much harder. Because even with the sheriff, he's appointed, he's not elected here in New York. Deal with that. And then I'm dealing with the provost marshal who's in the Army base.
Right.
And what's our Army base?
Fort Bragg?
Fort Hamilton.
Right.
Fort Hamilton Army base.
Right.
And he's very hard to get in touch with.
Right.
The provost marshal there. So how do I deal with that?
Let me mention again.
Now, I want to mention to all you all again, just like we're here doing the mock, and just like people come here and they go to other classes to start getting concepts together, what you have to do with each other is get the people that you're involved with out of this concept of collecting documents and trying to buy sovereignty with the Uniform Commercial Codes, and get them to deal with the principle that all of these things ultimately must be litigated under, and that is international law principle. You understand? All right, you're under occupation. There are still rules of war that go on. The problem with it is you keep not acting like you're being warred against. And so you keep approaching them as if you're in a proper jurisdiction and they're just not being fair, or you don't understand the procedures and like that, and yes but no, you know. And being a natural person, and this is also why you don't allow them or you object when they try to list you on their documents as pro se when you come there in appropriate persona, because as Brother Jelani was saying, you know, they don't have any authority to deal with a natural person in the first place. Other deal of it is, just because they declared war against their citizens, you're not their citizens. And this is why you never allow them to put any documents before you saying that you're a U.S. citizen. So anything that they deal with you, and they didn't have any documents, even if they got you under a kidnap under arbitrary, etc., and anything they said, you're a U.S. citizen, you not only you say no, you say that's why you always ask the judge for under discovery any documents they have relative to you, so that you can take it to counsel of your choice, which is logical, and then review it. You know, you don't make any decisions on anything they place before you in that court. You wait on discovery, take it with you, then you go back to your counsel, just like right, take your brother's argument, and then and when everybody's together, you have days where you come together with your legal affairs under the Qazi or whoever may be assigned, etc. That would be your Aboriginal Indigenous law area. And that's when you would have your regular business meetings to deal with those matters. You would present it. And furthermore, the truth of the matter is when you organize, those documents would have already been there before you even went to the court.
Right.
And this is where we keep blowing it. We keep trying to claim the sovereignty as individuals.
Brother, I do have one question for the brother who played the wrong defendant. And that question is, you kept stating on the record that you were with you. Okay.
By the way, that's enemy, the trading with the enemies act. Okay. That they say the United States citizen is an enemy of, enemy of the country.
Okay. What would have happened and would the whole adjudication have transpired if you had said, he kept asking for your name, if you had said, my appellation is, and then proceeded to give it, what would have happened at that point?
I just off experience, they'll ask, what is an appellation? I've heard them ask that. I would say, so, you know, some of them I just think are pretty dumb, or they're just very good actors, which, you know, depending on which way you want to go with it.
The reason being is because, remember, you have a situation of diversity of state. They don't have the authority to have any record on you. They don't have an authority to attempt to identify you. You see what I'm saying? So why would you give them a nomen or an appellation so they can put it on the record and put it in all caps? Then I don't have to waste my breath to go, I am John, capital J, lowercase O, H, now.
Yeah.
The thing about hearsay evidence, since this is a court of law, you're putting in evidence that you want to put on the record, most people don't remember the name that they were given at the time of their birth. So that means that any name that you choose to accept is some hearsay. You don't remember the time or the date of your birth.
What is the date of birth?
Usually somebody comes along and tells you that that's the date that you were born. And this was the name that you were given. But your dog calls you wolf, your cat calls you meow. And when they're happy with you, they call you one thing. When they're not happy with you, they call you another. So you have many different appellations. It's only inanimate objects typically that have a name. Not living natural beings.
And a date of birth is a legal term. Are you qualified to give a legal opinion? Do you even know what a date of birth is? Like you said, it's hearsay.
Right.
We were looking for Title 18, 241, 242. David found USC Title 42. The problem with that is that it deals with civil rights. If I add that, we don't want civil rights. 242. Every person who under color, that's 240. That's 42.
That's civil rights.
Right. Right. Keep coming down. Title 18.
Oh, all right.
Here we go.
Here it is. All right. Do you want to read it? Do you want to read it? All right. Now, see this arrow right there? That title. Thank you. I didn't see it. USC Title 18 Crime. 241. This arrow is how you arrow down to read it. It's two or more persons. We
want
to really, really
emphasize
this.
I'm going to read what these titles are because a lot of people do not know, and I know you don't, that this exists, and it is Title 18 that you utilize back to the courts or to anyone in the court officer that they can be, that they are violating and they can be sued for it. And it's, here's what it said.
Under Title 18, the United States Code, which covers crimes and criminal procedures. Under Section 241, Conspiracy Against Rights of Citizens, it states, if two or more persons conspire to injure, oppress, threaten, or intimidate any citizen in the free exercise or enjoyment of any right or privilege secured to him by the Constitution or laws of the United States, or because of his having so exercised the same, or if two or more persons go in disguise on the highway or on the premises of another with intent to prevent or hinder his free exercise or enjoyment of any right or privilege so secured, they shall be fined not more than $10,000 or imprisoned for not more than 10 years or both. And if death results, they shall be subject to imprisonment for any term of years or for life. Title 18, Criminal Procedures, this is 242, the deprivation of rights under color of law. Whoever under color of law of any law, statute, ordinance, regulation, or custom willfully subjects any inhabitant in any state, territory, or district to the deprivation of any rights, privileges, or immunities secured or protected by the Constitution or laws protected by the Constitution or laws of the United States, or the different punishments, pain, or penalties on account of such inhabitants being an alien or by reason of his color or race, then are prescribed for the punishment of citizens, shall be fined not more than $1,000 or imprisoned not more than 1 year or both. And if death results, shall be subject to imprisonment for any term of a year, of any term of years, or for life.
$11,000 per violation.
Right. Also, I just wanted to say.
Per violation.
That's per each, violation, that's for.
So that means when they all judges or magistrates, prosecutors,
any
of them can keep you from exercising your constitutional, your rights invested in the Constitution, you can go back on them and sue them with Title 18.
It also goes on, you can go on the FBI website and they'll tell you whose color of authority as well. You can go right on the FBI website, they'll tell you municipals, states, you know, state police, all of those different things, the color of authority. And they actually have some kind of complaint form that you can file against them as well for an investigation. That's all the FBI is, they just investigate. What they do is file a complaint with the Department of Justice, though. You see what I'm saying?
I believe they send the same thing through the mail. They now put a mail fraud on the Title 18 too, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes, I believe if they send a deprivation, some type of thing with respect to deprivation of rights through the mail, they now are committing mail fraud. I don't know what the penalty is for that, but I do know there's I believe that there's jail time for that.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh.
If a judge does that,
this is why you must know what fraud is, because there's no statute of limitation on fraud. This is also why it's important for the people to understand why you nationalize, because if you make a claim in a name that's not yours, you're done. It's civil litigation. You're dead in the eyes of law. So people need to understand, why is it that you nationalize? Why did Noble Raleigh start in 1913 what he did? Because none of these arguments can be made by you or for you if you're not national.
Right.
Your property. Do you understand? State property. So that must be understood intrinsically and absolutely.
Can you make us understand the process of filing liens?
Well, No. We're not doing liens now. We're doing mock court right now.
Well, basically this. Just like you do a mechanic's lien, like you do some work here, and you're not compensated for it. And the same way you file a lien, one of the things that I always suggest people do, whenever you go to court anyway, to their court, under whatever issue, you know, you're going under threat, arrest, and coercion, special appearance anyway, but they're going to act like you didn't anyway. But the point of it is, at that time, in this rehab organization, you start keeping a record. How much is he worth for the time that he spent it? And you construct a bill, and you send it to the municipality, and to the commissioner. You understand? Now, that bill, and you give them so many days to pay, and as soon as they default, you put a lien on them. And it was, you know, like when you go to court, and they give you a claim of so much for a fine, and then court support. When you go to court, make a bill. Every time you go to court, make a bill, and bill them, and mail it to them, certify it. And then, when they default on it, put a lien on it. But this is, again, where you come together, and these fundamentals you must learn. The other thing that I want to mention to you, like Brother Rogers mentioned to me earlier, and we talked about this many times. Another reason why we want to make sure that you all get your concepts together, because we want everyone who comes here to become more adept in what your position is, what your rights are, because we're going to put out a national call for class action suits in all the states of active conscious morals. But we don't want anyone involved who doesn't understand what they're doing. We want to make sure you understand what this is, what you're doing, and you're going to file suits. And you're going not, and we ain't just talking about with the head. You'll put them on notice. But there's still an international venue here. Just like you can file a suit in another state, another state, and state does not mean like New York. State means a political system. This is a state right here. And you have a right to exercise and determine your own status of the state, but you must be national. And some of these fundamental principles you must understand is what Ill Malik was trying to tell some of the people before they bumped him off, that he woke up to. Do you understand what I'm saying to you? The deal of it is that you must become absolutely conscious of what everybody was promising to tell and didn't tell you. Do you understand? So we want to make sure that you understand, so we're going to tell you. But logically, like anything else, you will not get this conceptually just in a conversational couple meetings. You must conceptually be involved in your civil affairs so you can become conscious really what nationality and birthright actually is. So anyone who's a signatory to the suit, we're not only going to send a copy, you understand, to the Supreme Court, not these district courts, the single one in Washington, the United States Court, not the district court of, you understand, the one that people don't know that's really the only operational one. Of course, it puts them on the spot. And again, when you notify the Department of Justice, they have an obligation to do an investigation. So you can write an ordinary letter of complaint of an injury to yourself, name the parties, mail it to them, and propose, you know, put these CCs on it. And if you start doing that, because remember, a lot of times, and I'm going to tell you honestly, a lot of times when we deal with wars in these state courts, it's really because we want you to get the exercise and the will to fight, not that we expect you to win. We're really trying to get you, trying to turn that jab, you know, like, no, not. Sam.
Snap.
You understand what I'm saying?
Turn that fist.
You understand? Now we're going to give you a little exercise. You're going to get beat up sometimes. You get beat up anyway. But when you become adept, now we're going to get in the ring and knock Tyson out. You understand? Because you're going to understand what you're doing. You're not going to be operating on emotions. But understand, so in due time, and what we're going to do, we're going to issue another issue of the Al-Moroccan Star, and we'll put that out nationally. We also will put it on the website, but we're going to make sure that y'all got it going on.
Yeah, I just wanted to read Title 18, United States Code, Part 1, Chapter 45, Subsection 970. It said, protection of property occupied by foreign governments. Whoever willfully injures, damages, or destroys, or attempts to injure, damage, or destroy any property, real or personal, located within the United States and belonging to or utilized or occupied by any foreign government or international organization by a foreign official or official guest shall be fined under this title or imprisoned not more than 5 years or both. Whoever willfully with intent to intimidate, coerce, threaten, or harass, forcibly thrust any part of himself or any object within or upon that portion of any building or premises located within the United States, which portion is used or occupied for official business or for diplomatic, consular, or residential purposes by a foreign government, including such use as a mission to an international organization, and b, an international organization, c, a foreign official, or d, an official guest, or two, refuses to depart from such portion of such building or premises after a request by a, an employee of a foreign government or of an international organization, if such employee is authorized to make such request by the senior official of the unit of such government or organization which occupies such portion of such building or premises, b, by a foreign official or any member of the foreign official staff who is authorized by the foreign official to make such request by an official guest or any member of the official guest staff who is authorized by the official guest to make such request, d, by any person present having law enforcement powers, shall be fined under this title or imprisoned not more than 6 months or both. C, for the purpose of this section, foreign government, foreign official, international organization, and official guest shall have the same meanings as those provided in section 1116B of this title. In the course of enforcement of this section and any other sections prohibiting a conspiracy or attempt to violate this section, the Attorney General may request assistance from any federal, state, or local agency, including the Army, Navy, and Air Force, any statute, rule, or regulation to the contrary notwithstanding. I just wanted to read that, and it's just one last piece in here where it talks about, let me just see if I can pull it up. It says it defines what a foreign government is, and it discusses how it's not how it doesn't have to be recognized by the United States.
The United States is unlawful in itself. Those persons. So you don't need their acknowledgement.
Right. That's
and
the point.
Back to also when a lot of Moors get this idea, that they have to file with them or file not with them.
Right.
What title was that routine again?
What you've got to be is national in the first place, in the first instance, and get away from the concept of doing emergency crash nationalizations.
What title is that? In that title,
I'm pulling up.
Title. He wants to know the title.
It's a blank screen. I'm pulling it back up. Hold on 1 second.
All right, after he gives you that information, we're going to do another one. Someone to come up
ad hoc.
Who wants to come up and just
for trial?
Come up
is it? And judge will beat up on them.
But first, they got to talk to the prosecutor.
Prosecutor.
And then it'll go on anybody.
And Nico's going to beat up on them.
I'd like to point something out. I've done quite a bit of research in this area of law that coincides with everything that's been stated. When the conspiracy stuff was mentioned a while ago, some thoughts may have gone through some people's minds about how the hell can I prosecute these people in these governments in a conspiratorial way. It happens to be very, very easy. And just as the law was being read about what we know they are doing in government and how we are being affected by it, all we have to do is start using those laws against them instead of being fools the way they use those laws, because they bring the paperwork to court. They put everybody on the defensive, and you can never win playing defense, all right? We have to pull their asses into court the way they do it to everybody else and let them know that we're tired of what they're doing. That's a simple way to phrase it, but Beyond that, conspiracy is so easy to prove, it's almost a joke. You don't have to prove that they spoke about anything in connection with you or me or any of us. You don't have to prove that they plotted it, that they planned it. It's just this simple. You only have to show that person A did that part of the damage that occurred to you. You then show person B did that part of the damage that occurred to you. Person C or some government agency or whatever did that part of the damage to you. That is all that the law requires to prove conspiracy, not what you're looking at on TV or in movies. It's all baloney. And by the way, civil RICO is much more powerful than these laws. And one simple thing that gives you a lot more power, that's going to help you financially and help our nation, whatever that ultimately becomes financially, is if you use something like RICO, just like those laws were mentioned, file it under a law that's going to hurt somebody, not tap them on the wrist. Whatever a jury decides about our damages using civil RICO, it gets tripled automatically by law. That's just for starters. There's a lot of other advantages.
That's right.
Right, hey, brother.
Thank you.
That quote was Title 18, Part 1, Chapter 45, Subsection 97. But that's the protection of property occupied by foreign governments. And then the other one,
this is like when they come to your house or anything. And this is another reason why it's important for you to be national. And also have those notices, you know, like in your own paper. But remember, the more conscious you get, the less clerks and others will be willing to take any documents from you to file them. Because it creates a liability for them.
Right.
So this is why you should also have your own paper.
So imagine that it also would apply against you if you're, say, visiting, nursing home patient or something like that?
I want to make sure everybody hears you. Excuse me.
I said again, I would imagine that it would also be working against you if you were, say, visiting someone in a nursing home or a hospital and then you're being asked to leave or not recognized for your identity.
Now remember, and this is when you go back to even under the Clinton administration, when they reaffirmed the obligation of the several states to recognize treaties, etc., and also them being a party of the United Nations, they have an obligation under international law to recognize indigenous people's documents. But what we fail to do is sue them on those principles because they're violating you then. But they're denationalizing you then. They're making you a straw at that time because they're interfering with your rights. And at that time, you can sue that person. That's why you want to keep that consciousness and keep a record. Always don't fail to make notes when you're dealing with different people so that you can also send that to your own law firm and plan suits against these persons. And once you start causing them, you know, after a while they'll start, oh, you got anything else you want to show me?
No. I was trying to figure that if it comes possible, where do they try to trap you off? Can you possibly?
That's what we just showed you. Right. You know, again, I want to make mention of this, and this is to those who come here. Keep this in mind. One of the biggest mistakes I see that most wars make when they keep trying to be somebody else other than who they are. Understand that the judges are Masons. The industrialists are Masons. The high priests are Masons. The reverends are Masons. You understand? The rabbis are Masons. They got affairs. You understand? They didn't make treaties with the left-hand Moors with the tan sneaks. And they didn't make treaties with the feather cap Moors. You understand? And they didn't make treaties with the Blackfoot Moors. They made the treaties with the Moroccan Empire.
That's right. All right. I mean, the Pope.
When you divide yourself, you lose your sovereignty. You're clipping yourself. You understand? All these Asiatics are Moors. And once you start honoring your brothers and fathers, the law is behind you. Once you start trying to play that game, you know, oh, she's got the earrings on. So she's the earring Moor. As soon as you start that Disney stuff, this man knows that you don't understand birthright. And you're just giving him a mandate. You understand? And so remember that Tom Jefferson, Benjamin Franklin, John Adams, John Barclay as an agent in business, were assigned ministers plenipotentiary. That's why you got potentate in masonry. They ain't the founding fathers. We're the founding fathers that gave them authority to treat with us. Before the Articles of Association and Confederation was made, that's the great Masonic secret of what you call the Great Seal. And if you don't understand that, you're going to approach this whole thing wrong. You understand? You got to have that in your head and in your heart and in your mind. And understand, dumb people are not going to tell you those things. You understand? But that's in their mind as soon as they see you. As soon as you get that bay or eel, the first thing they're going to see where your mind is coming from. And if your mind is not coming from that angle, they're going to know you went down 7-Eleven or down CVS somewhere and copied some papers and bought some package from somebody and you're a fool.
Islam, family, yeah, and that's the truth. That's why you have to be who you say you are, like in the courtroom. Yeah, when I'm ever questioned or put on the podium, I just say I am that I am. So that speaks volumes, because they're Masons, so they know what I am, that I am me, because they're ADAPT chamber members as well. So that's who I am. I've come to lay a solid rock, a sure foundation stone, in which this temple can never be destroyed. So see, these are things that they can challenge. So like the brother said, they can, but see, once you hold to the Constitution, they can't do anything for the record of peace.
I just wanted to say this real quick too, a couple of things. Like the brother said, you know, just realizing when you're in municipal court though, like, you know, everybody knows what's going on. Pope, you can find that picture that Mother Rod showed earlier. That's on the New York Times website.
With the Pope?
Yeah, with the Pope. And when you look up, just go to Wikipedia and type in Pope's coat of arms or, you know, shield or whatever. And they'll tell you a Moor's head. It doesn't say a black man's head. It doesn't say African-American head. It doesn't say African head. It says a Moor's head. You know what I mean? And he was standing there like he was Christ with his arms out, with this big old Moor at the top of it. So I don't know what else is necessary to explain, but also, just a strategy real quick. You know,
but no. I'm saying he wants to make a comment to that, and I wanted to say that you said that he had his hands stretched out like Christ.
Right.
He is, and they and
I know, right?
No,
yeah.
No. It's called the vicar.
As your repository, you're the clerk of court. You have the concept, the mentality that you are the Article III judge. So that way, when they don't respond, when you refuse their contract, and they don't drop the case, you can put a default judgment on them. By understanding, you know, civil procedure and things of that nature.
Okay.
All right.
Yeah, that's right. All right, you got it.
This is one thing, but just to add on, like a lot of times when you're in municipal court, the new thing they're doing is, well, I don't know if it's new, but they'll try to refer you to a psychiatrist or something. No, literally, they will. And no, they really will. They really will try to do that. They'll say that what you're saying is not applicable for the venue. So they'll, you know, refer you to a psychiatrist. But I just say this real quick. And then what happens is you gotta utilize that though, because they're gonna assess your state of mind. A psychiatrist and stuff, doesn't matter their creed, race, or whatever. They're very smart individuals. So, you know, what you have to do is go in there and you know, if you have to go in there and get a psychiatrist evaluation or psych evaluation, you want to document the duress that you've been under, because then you can turn around and use that in the suit as well. You see what I'm saying?
Or use the signs behind that. They call that hearing a 7:30 hearing. I know anyone who's ever dealt with that, they call it a 7:30 hearing. And the reason why is because under the Torah and other certain forms of law, an individual is supposed to be, is claimed to be in an insane mind at least twice a day. So when you take the two and multiply by 365, you get to 7:30.
Oh, okay. Wow.
Thank you, Governor.
This last thing, just to read, this is for just so everybody has a clear understanding about foreign governments, and you know, when the municipals, the states, or whatever they are, you know, when they come at you and say that you're fraudulent or you're full of something, this is out of Title 18, Part 1, Chapter 1, Subsection 11. It says, foreign government defined. The term foreign government, as used in this title, except for Sections 112, 87, 89, 70, 1116, and 1201, includes any government, faction, or body of insurgents within a country with which the United States is at peace, irrespective of recognition by the United States. So even saying they own the United States code, that they don't have to respect you as a foreign government for you to be a foreign government. So yeah, that's very key. And the thing is, you know, going to them, one of the main things is when you go to them for documentation, you get the authentication, they're just putting a seal on it. You know, so when you start to get your own government, you start to get our own governments, you know, properly organized and get back to the constitutional goal of things, then, you know, you can start effectuating things as a government. So,
it's also important because the consciousness that has been displayed in North America for the last 20, 25 years has inspired a lot of the other Americans to start nationalizing their other states. And so when you see the states, the southern states, you must understand states don't mean, you know, like New York, New Jersey. States is nations or states, all right? And just like we've got the OAS, the Organization of American States. And this is why you also must not allow them to get away with calling this country America without challenging them and correcting them. Because this country has no name. You understand? Because this is Morocco. Morocco's under occupation, which is why they just say America. But America, the American states go from Alaska to Chile, and all of those are Americans. And the American states have already spoken on your behalf. And Raleigh spoke for you. But the deal is, you have to make your brothers and sisters conscious so they can claim their lost estate and their inheritance and get them out of believing anything and start acting like they know. You know, now, and again, I want to remind you all, one of the reasons why we have you sign in is because you're dealing with Moorish affairs. You are the state. Do you understand? All right. So, and if you're national, and this is one of the reasons, again, why we want to remind you what nationality does on a legal perspective, both foreign jurisdictions and your domicile jurisdiction, et cetera, and on your land. And until we correct that with the people, the arguments that they've been placing or putting forth have no validity because they don't carry with stateless persons. You understand, a stateless person automatically comes as a ward of the state. And as a ward of the state, and I want to remind you all too, I want to give you a legal perspective so that you'll understand arguments too. One of the reasons why they call the occupied people minorities is because that's a legal status. It doesn't just mean an infant in the perspective that you think it does. And it doesn't mean just numbers in a minority position as you think it does. It means a status. Once these people, under the leadership of agents that work with the occupied government, start agreeing that they were people of color and minority, they didn't know that they were legal terms. Now, under the wardship, and you know, the military wardship, you know, that's what yellow flags, or brown flags, under wardship, they don't have to account for the profits made off of the person. And they have what you call jurisdictional control of both the body and the land. Do you understand? I mean, is everybody clear on this? Follow me. Everybody clear? Under wardship tenures, or military rule, which is what's happening, they have jurisdiction over the person, personal jurisdiction, and the land, and don't have to account for the profits. If you agree that you're a minority, even after you become 21, you are still a ward, And this is the trick on why they perpetrated that minority stuff amongst us and then put leaders that were assigned amongst you to keep pushing that as if it has some legitimacy, when actually they were painting you into wardship in perpetuity. So don't allow anybody to call you a minority. It's another reason why you must be yourself. I just want to put that out there.
Are we ready for the next case? What's the name? Because we need to get out. It's 9:30. We have to be out by 10. And I wanted to get it. Do y'all have it together? Or? He's not.
You ain't defending me?
No. We just set it up. Because typically, the prosecutor in the courtroom is the one who's supposed to have the case, the claim against you. That's what he says anyway. But upon asking him, such as Brother Giovanni did, he was setting up to ask, what's your nationality? The next thing he was going to do was ask the prosecutor what their nationality was, right, Giovanni? The next thing he was going to do was ask the prosecutor what his nationality was, and then ask, do they have a claim against him, of which he's going to say he's prosecutor John Smith, and he does not have a claim against him. And the judge certainly can't have a claim against you. He's only supposed to be the mediator, supposedly, or the magistrate. So once you say, for the record, state your name for the record, do you have a claim against me? He says no. And he states his name, the judge, for the record, the nationality, do you have a claim? He's got to say no. Then you say, well, who does? And I say, the state of. Well, state of is a corporation, it's fictitious, it cannot show itself, so therefore, you must face your accuser, and it can't be done. So that's the fictitious. So that's what he was actually setting up for. Did you want to add something to that?
Yeah, just very quick. And another reason why
I didn't really pay too much attention to the prosecutor is because I'm in here in pro sense of jurors. I'm not pro se. When you claim pro se, then you put the prosecutor in the equation. The only person I want to talk to is this judge. You see what I'm saying? He's a mute poem right now. You know, he's not existing. You know what I'm saying? So that's why I really didn't pay too much attention to what the prosecutor was talking about.
What's your status in persona?
In pro persona, sir, jurors.
In
pro persona.
Impropria, meaning Latin, improper person, in pro persona.
One's own proper person.
Like you could be somebody else's, right? Proper. Excuse me? The what?
Black's Law Dictionary.
Oh, Black's Law Dictionary, yes. We can read that. We'll make that thing. Well, would you find it? Now, this case is going to be, this situation is going to be one where the brother is the defendant. He don't know nothing about being a proper person, right? He just not in the courtroom like most people, all right? And he got a little situation that he's creating here, whatever it may be. We'll know in 1 minute, and let's see what happens. And we're going to show you what the judge is going to do. I know you're going to get beat up, because that's all that you can do. And then, if he should hire an attorney, one that is an at-law, well, you want to play the attorney for him? No, you don't know, he can't even do it. It ain't even in his soul and his bones to play no attorney. To be someone to put somebody in a tourniquet. He can't do it. He can't play at-law because the only real lawyers are Morris. You are the law. So nobody wants to play the attorney for him, y'all. You know, I think he's gonna get beat up pretty bad. So we don't need an attorney, right? Or I don't know, Judge. You might have to say. Now here's why the judge said, "Come back here with an attorney," because he just wants to make sure that they get a little piece of the finances and go to avoid that work. That's all. And then the attorney makes you think that he's gonna represent you, and all he's really gonna do is they may have wanted to charge you $5,000. He said, "Look, I can get this down to $3,000 or something like that." That's all they're doing is playing games with you, for real. All right, what are we looking for?
All right.
And propria persona, and one's own proper person. I mean, she can't be in someone else's. It is a rule in pleading that pleas to the jurisdiction of the court must be pled in proper and appropriate persona. Because if pleaded by an attorney, they admit the jurisdiction. As an attorney is an officer of the court, and he is presumed to plead after having obtained leave, which admits the jurisdiction.
Hello, you can't get an attorney. You're admitting to the jurisdiction.
So you better
not. Can be done. So, next case, prosecutor. You ready? Oh, well, judge got to go to take a rest, to the restroom. But now the brother's here, the first thing he's going to do.
Yeah, I'm just. Yeah,
isn't he going to come and talk to the prosecutor? Like,
yeah.
Oh, y'all already did that part.
Yeah, it's just, you know, just. Trying to do some things, you know, just throwing some scenarios out there. It's not that form. We have, it's all for sex and purposes and childhood.
Yes.
Push that up.
We have, John Smith, the defendant John Smith versus State of New Jersey. The defendant has a illegal possession of a firearm. State your name for the record, sir.
John Smith. Sit down so we can stand up.
John Smith.
John Smith, I see you have a legal possession of a firearm.
You gotta stay raised, bro.
John Smith, I see you have
can't beat up on you if you gonna sit down.
A firearm in the state of New York, of New Jersey, in the state of New Jersey.
I don't understand the state of New Jersey.
What do you not understand about the state of New Jersey, sir?
I don't understand the term.
Okay, well, sir, you say you need to get an attorney for that so he can explain that to you?
Well, me knowing a little bit, I don't need an attorney, actually.
With me being my own,
I can actually say...
So you're representing yourself?
Yes, as a pro se defendant, yes.
Okay. All right, so sir, being that you have these charges here, how would you like to plead to this?
I will not plead because there's not an injured party.
The state of New York says the state of New Jersey is the injured party, sir.
There's no injured party, actually, because New Jersey cannot be a state.
Prosecutor, do you have anything you'd like to add to these charges?
Yes, Your Honor. The defendant was found, was charged with illegal possession of a firearm
without a license. He doesn't have any license to carry one. He actually has a criminal record. He's a felon, so he's not supposed to have those things. Defendant, in initial reports, as you can see here, stated that he would seek an attorney, but I guess he's not doing it now. So the bottom line, Your Honor, is that he's a felon. He was found with a legal firearm, possession of a firearm, Your Honor. And that statute carries a maximum of 10 years. So, is he going to plead guilty or not guilty, Your Honor? Because this is pretty much basic stuff. Sir, as you know, in the how long you've lived in this state, but in the state of New Jersey, it is known fact that all citizens of the state of New Jersey must carry a license for all firearms. And the penalty is $10,000 per charge.
First off, me being not a felon, because I was never convicted of a felony. And second, I will not plead guilty today because in the United States Constitution, we have a right to bear arms. If you check, I'm not sure.
Can you cite that, sir?
Actually, if I'm not, I think it's Article.
The defendant was found on December 1996, he was convicted. Vehicular manslaughter, just got out about 2 months ago. He's been found with the legal possession of a firearm.
Sir, just for the record, are you a resident of New Jersey?
No, I'm not a resident of New Jersey.
Okay, what do you consider yourself, sir?
Actually, my nationality is of Asiatic descent. Is my origin.
Say he's not a convicted felon. He was convicted in 1997 of vehicular manslaughter. There goes the criminal record, the arrest record as well, Your Honor. Defendant also has been arrested several times for domestic violence. I'm saying, he throw the book at you. They come at you hard. They'll dig into it. So clearly the defendant is not under, he's not aware that he's under oath. You are aware you're under oath. Your Honor, I have nothing more further to say other than to that the court give recommendation for a psych evaluation. The defendant is clearly not, nothing that the defendant is saying is intelligible. It's all unintelligible. So I just recommend that the court, on behalf of the court, that you, recommend that he gets a psych evaluation to see if he's fit to stand trial. Or is he, or should you give him an attorney? Clearly not able to represent himself.
No, he's not
responding. No, this defendant's not competent to stand trial at this time. I recommend that he seek psych evaluation at this time. This case is adjourned.
And then we can hold you to it.
This is another thing. When they say that you had a weapon. You said, no, I have no weapons. Not only was it a subject matter, he knew because he didn't have any weapons. He was bearing arms, exercising a right. You don't have any weapons. And it's not semantics. That's number one. Number two.
But can I ask you something, though? Because this is an opportunity for me to learn as well, since you said that. But he, from the beginning, he said he was John Smith.
Yes, he was John. Well,
he was John Smith.
They only accepted the jurisdiction.
Right. So, but then he accepted the status that is attached. All that he's
contracted
is attached to all those different things. So, whether he had the weapon or not, is still subject. Correct me if I'm wrong, but is he still subject to based on the fact that he said he was an artificial entity
and pro se.
And pro se.
So he can be pro secuted.
Right.
But again, and it goes back to when you say you're pro se, all right, they can hold you to a standard of their form and procedure.
Right.
In propria persona, first of all, they don't have the authority to deal with you in the first place.
Right.
Of course, under writ, et cetera, any accusation that you had, that they had against you, under writ of discovery, you're supposed to be had walked in here with all those things in front of you anyway, not just in front of you, but having them in your possession, and also having the time to have reviewed them with counsel before you became here. So since they didn't do that, now you can tell if they'll do his job and see that that takes place now, you can stop everything.
Right.
You'll stop the court. No, and there's no corpus electi. Yes.
Even if he was to mess up on in persona, and he was just completely bound that, and you messed up the whole process, he could still get his case dismissed by just challenging subject matter alone.
Yeah.
Now this is my thing.
Because a lot of us theorize, right?
Because we're just going off the hair, off the cuff here. But my thing is, with the case, see, the thing is, a lot of different things that go into, when you're in there, you're making these debates back and forth about these issues, it's a gun charge.
Yes.
So that's a very juicy case for them.
Yeah.
They want to put you away for that.
Yes.
Then, the history behind it, you know what I mean?
Yes, that's why they pack it.
So the thing is, like when you say they could be dismissed, but to me, it's more of a discretionary thing.
You'd argue each issue and tell the judge to knock it down, and you give him cause for knocking it down.
Right. I understand that. What I'm saying, though, is when you say that he could actually, because I'm saying in reality, like when they look at that stuff, it's juicy to them.
Yeah.
So what I'm saying is them being nice when you say, we dismiss it. Because when you're establishing your status and putting it on the record, they try to adjudicate anyway.
Yes, they try to go past jurisdiction.
You see what I'm saying? So if whether you're saying that or you're not, when you got those kind of stats in front of them, I'm saying the intensity at which they go at that, what do you think is the realistic way to handle that?
First of all, again, and this is what I'm saying, because basically they're trying to broadside you.
Right.
Now, the deal of it is, you would say,
like you said,
there are two charges.
Right.
And you also deal with the issue of corpus electi.
Right.
Where you already know that. I would take the position, rather than try to battle that, under rule discovery, that he wants all your claims.
So basically,
and even if
you don't get into it, just say...
Yeah, you don't argue. Don't argue the matter. Don't argue the matter.
All right, I got you.
Because that creates a jurisdiction.
Right.
You say object. Under rule discovery, judge, I had no opportunity to review them, to examine them from a legal perspective to see if the claims are corrected, to see if there's any misrepresentation, to see if there's any hearsay. I have no indictment paper on some of these charges in front of me. Under rule discovery, since he's the accuser, I want that, and I want to have time to go see my counsel and go over these documents, examine the language to see if it fits or not, etc. And of course, you already know, Your Honor, that we've already started adjudicating that's a violation of due process because we haven't really cleared up the issue with the status and even the venue, the jurisdiction and the venue. And I'm not challenging, but I am questioning, you know, the claim of the jurisdiction, particularly in this particular venue. That's exactly correct, you know. Anyway, for the time being, on that grounds, anyway, I would ask to dismiss. And if not, rule discovery, let me prepare. Now, this is where you take the documents, and you can 9 times out of 10 find all kind of holes, starting even with the capital letters, you know what I mean, that ain't you. And then you take it to the council, to your council, in your due time, then you set a date, and give yourself a couple months. Say, I'll need a couple months, and, you know, we'll go examine this, and then we'll get back with you. Meanwhile, what you do, you get back with your counsel, then you start preparing your documents properly, and then have them set in and deal with a trial de novo. You know what I mean?
So essentially you're saying that you get the situation delayed by entering in the fact that you haven't had a chance to review the documents.
Yeah, that, on the writ of discovery.
Right.
Because, you know, because they're making that, that's entered as evidence.
But see, this is what they're doing now, too. Like, want you to have a state ID when you get
the stuff
now.
You do have a state ID. You got a nationality card?
Right. I mean,
see, but this is back to Moore's understanding what a nationality card is, and understand that we're Aboriginal Indigenous people.
Right.
And you have determined your own status of the state.
Right.
In accord with the law. Here's my state ID. You talk about your state, no, this is my state.
Right.
It's a state of mind.
Yeah, and that too. And then, oh, Judge, oh, what you're saying, I should have figured it out.
Right.
You're claiming for the record there's a diversity of law and a diversity of citizenship. Thank you. Then this, apparently this is an improper jurisdiction, isn't it?
Right. Right.
We don't need to discuss it, do we?
So I'm saying that, as far as, like, you try to prepare before entering to get the discovery, you know, you
got to
go through a little...
You can ask for discovery right on the spot.
Yeah, I know that.
And stop the court.
I'm saying, like, before the proceeding to start, before the court appearance is required, and you try to get those documents, you know...
No, this is what I would do. Mm-hmm. Issue a writ of discovery.
Right.
With a time period for them to deliver. You understand? Skip 10 days to deliver, and you only issue your papers, you know, before your tribunal date, with the caveat under it. And if they do not respond and ask all questions, you will assume that they made a misjudgment, a mistake.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying? And will consider that they have acquiesced, and then any claim that they may have had, etc., is expunged, dead, void.
To file a judgment against them for not responding.
Yes, exactly.
Right.
And then when they don't respond, because you already know the questions that you're going to put in that written,
right,
and they're not going to fill out, because it's going to make them liable.
Yeah, I did once. That's how I got the discovery, because they didn't want to give it to me at first. But I did just for the indicator, you know, like, since they're
the
attorney
general,
since he did
the state
judges and all
that,
they put that thing out easy.
Yes. And then, again.
Yeah,
and this is another reason why I would suggest to CC it to more than one department,
right,
to cause them, yeah, to have to discuss it, right. And it's usually easier for them to dismiss it than to discuss it and then try to continue that action. Because
right.
If they pursue that action and they've discussed it with someone else, that's conspiracy.
And you can also use a process server, so now you have a witness.
Yes.
Yeah.
Right,
and if you register mail, now you have, you know, that way they can't say, oh, I never received it. They signed for it, they can't.
That's right.
They can't deny it.
Yeah, that's why sending certified mail is good, too, because you have to have somebody sign it.
Yes. And that's also why you also, I always say, always be prepared from the door while you're dealing with them, while they have you into that colorful jurisdiction. And litigation, that you be making up a rate, and that you send them a bill, and send them that bill, and that's another instrument just conjunctive with all these actions that are taking place. So while they're trying to make you, you know, contract with them, and then they're automatically got plans on making a bill with you, you're making a bill with them, and you're going to send that in.
It's just a balance sheet, like a...
Yes.
When they talk about the T-bill, the cross.
Yes.
You know, the charges on each side, well, it goes both ways. That's why I was, you know, I was referencing the judgments, how they're trying to adjudicate you into judgment for each time they try to get you into dishonor. By them dishonoring you and you holding them liable, you can charge them.
Yes.
Particulars as well.
And then when they don't compensate, put a lien on.
Through a formal lawsuit.
Yes.
What you're getting at.
Yes, and including arbitrary. Like, say, for instance,
a lawsuit.
Yeah. So,
let me ask you a question real quick. Do you suggest when you write them with this, do you, because of fraud, you ask the U.S. Congress? It's not lawful money,
and the motion says. No, you do that. All you gotta say is lawful United States money, as per Article 1, Section 10. You know, just like, say, for instance, all right, they lock up your man for something, right? Huh? You can also sue them for arbitrary for the absence of your man.
Even MELPRA, if they keep trying to send you stuff that you've. You know, disengage their contracts. If they keep trying to send you subsequent correspondence, you can get them on MELPRA charges. But you have to get into more of, you know, how you prosecute them on those type of charges.
But and that's evidence.
That just takes more research, though.
Yeah, and their documents become the evidence. So that's for the sister. So keep that in mind. So remember, and that's vice versa for brothers. If they're hooking up on the sister. You understand? You can get them for arbitrary that. That's like, so if they lock up your man under cover, so he can sue them, you can sue them too, because they took your husband. That's called arbitrary. Same thing. Now part one, article five, the article six, part two, article six, rights of indigenous people, that they can't take your children from you under any pretext. And that goes to the non-support thing, the game they play.
Now, what's up with this thing with the fact that the United States don't have signed the Declaration of Indigenous Rights?
Just like, what did you just read there?
Yeah, I know.
Whether they acknowledge it or not, they're obligated. And remember, the rule is under a color of law. Mm-hmm. Anything done under a color of law, they don't need to understand it. Mm-hmm. They're as responsible as if they did, because they got a title, they got weapons, and they've been talking trash. You know, they're held to the law, and they can say, well, I don't know about that. In the law, they are responsible. In other words, if you say you're a brain surgeon, you're responsible for anatomy.
Come on, brother. Here.
I wanted to know, all right, before, I know you have to get nationalized and everything. That's
first. You have to get conscious. So first thing, I would ask you, what is nationality?
So, let me say this. Somebody talk about nationality. Nationality is not the card. Nationality is a consciousness and the collective knowledge of what it pertains to you being of a nation, either homogeneous, or juristic. You must know which one you're talking about. You must name it. You must know your constitutional principles. You must have a flag and seal. And you must present prior to the action, it is in your best interest to already be operative. Do you understand the words? Don't get in trouble and then all of a sudden want to get nationalized. Not that doesn't work, but don't put yourself in a position where it gives appearance that you just get national to try to get out of a contract.
Right.
No, that's not what I'm saying. This is for everyone's information. Now, nationality is one having been either reclaimed by your nation. So let's make a distinction. There's nationalization and then there's naturalization. Naturalization is the issue where in a juristic type of state structure, whereas a foreign or alien is brought into the political forum of the body politic by privilege and is given a nationality card. And so that is conditional, all right, and can be taken from you. Nationalization is when you are of that nation by blood, consanguine principle, pedigree. Meaning that you are more, that's your blood. Whether you acknowledge it or not, that's who you are. All right, that is homogeneous. You understand what I'm saying? If someone come here from another nation and we accept them into our tribes, which we often have done, then that would be a naturalization. And so if you have a Moor so-called naturalizing you, a Moor can't be naturalized, not here in the Americas, because you're aboriginal to the land. You can naturalize someone else, but they can't naturalize you. If you fall for that, somebody do, they just actually denationalize you. So this is also what Moors should understand. If a body of Moors or one of the tribes are naturalizing you, they're actually robbing you. Because they're claiming you will be an alien. You can't be an alien to your inheritance. do you understand?
Okay, right, that's for everyone.
All right, so keep that in mind.
Excuse me. We're going to have to close. Did you have one question here? He has a question right there. And then that's, we will close out and then proceed to.
When the government on a document, the government, someone said that someone had a meeting in Washington. Somebody in the meeting said, send those niggas back to Africa. Mm-hmm. And the guy who was in charge of the meeting said, we can't do that because they are a natural heritage to the land.
All right, now.
Bound to the common divine heritage.
This is the whole point. Tamari. The land over there is Tamari. You're standing on Africa. Now, that's another great Masonic secret. If you don't know that, your concepts are wrong. So they say send you back to Africa. What they mean is send you back to your right mind. They can't do that. It's impossible.
Say that again.
If they say send you back to Africa, which very often they do for people who don't know what's up, the concept is that you're going someplace. No, they're actually threatening their own position because they're sending you back to your right mind. Then once they send you there and then you speak to Cyprian Africanus, the Roman general, then you go back to Mexico and you find out that you're a traveling man, but you haven't moved a step. Because you're home. You're here by birthright and inheritance. They can't send you anyplace. All they can do is build jails and hold you on the wardship. That's why it was important for them to tag us as Negro, Black, or Colored, and minorities, and to get your quote-unquote assumed to be leaders to call you minority and or people of color, which means you're an artificial person, which makes you 14th Amendment. Do you understand? Because that's what color means, all right? Corporate entity, and not a natural person, which makes you similar to mortus, having no judicial stand-by, no standing in law, all right? Then you're transacting in their name, which puts you under wardship tenders, which legitimizes that flag with the yellow fringes. And so they deal with both booty and prize, not just prize, or booty and prize. And since you are a minority, no matter how old you are, you're not capable of doing anything in any sovereign capacity, no matter what your age. And so you remain under wardship tenures, under the state's jurisdiction corporation, i.e., that's the game. Do you understand? But yet, at the same time, you have amnesia, and they're just simply enjoying your estate. But they don't have to account for the profits, because you're under wardship tenures. So this is why I told you earlier, do not call yourself minority. Don't let somebody else call you minority. Don't call yourself people of color, because it's a legal phrase. It's not an identity. This is why they trap people with the idea that that is the identity of these persons under wardship. And once you take the concept that that is an identity, you hold on to it. But you don't know what you just did is legally imprisoned yourself. It's called mental slavery. That's what Noble Drolley talked about. Do you understand? All right.
Wow, what a note to credit him. Well, that was great. That was great. We had fun. I think the mock court was fun. And we'll be here next week. Every third Wednesday of the week, we're going to have an etymology class so that we can all learn how to really read, because we don't really know how to read. And Abdullah Talib Al-Mosi Bey will be giving that class every third Wednesday. I didn't get to talk to Tawfiq. To confirm that he was going to be doing the Marshall demonstration, because that's the fifth week Wednesday. It's next week, the fifth week. It happens to be five Wednesdays in this month. There he is. I called him up. Yeah. Oh, dear, did you hear me mention your name?
No.
Oh, did you see how the mind all works? I said I didn't get to talk to Tawfiq to affirm that he would be doing a martial law demonstration. And as soon as I said it, did he walk in? I mean, he didn't even hear it. All right, peace. So the affirmation is, will you be doing a demonstration next Wednesday?
The affirmation is.
Will you, can you, yes. Are you, next Wednesday?
Yes.
Yes?
Yes.
Right here. He's going to demonstrate what the energy, right here in the house, what the energy of Aries, which is going out now, and that energy is going to be handed off to Tauruses. So if you know any Tauruses, they're getting a little bully right now. They're getting a little antsy. They're getting a little out of control, because they're getting ready to get all this energy that's going to be coming their way. And then they're going to try to stabilize it. That's why they don't move, they don't want to change anything, and they want to be in serious control, because they want to stabilize the energy.
Watch out for your horns.
So watch out for their horns, because they're getting ready to get all the energy passed on to them through air. So next week, right here, demonstration of what the spring energy is that has just come in. All right, so we will see you all next Wednesday, I hope. Peace and love. Thank you. Oh, wait a minute. One more thing.
Islam family.
Islam,
bro. Islam family.
Islam.
Islam family.
Islam.
Come on now. Y'all gotta come better than that. This is not no cemetery. Y'all talking to Dr. Shaka Zulu now. Y'all have some great brothers that sat up here and gave y'all some wonderful information. Let's give them a round of applause. A boys round of applause. It is good to see the formulation of our own very own Morris University of Sciences right here. That's right. But the message that I wanted to just drop on to y'all briefly is the importance of coming out to the United Nations meeting that we're having this year for the 7th annual session of Indigenous Peoples Conference that's been taking place from April 21st all the way to May 2nd. What is happening is have Moors or Indigenous individuals who have asserted themselves at the United Nations. And we have a seat there, not just as an individual, we have a seat there on behalf of all of the Moors that are standing here today.
That's right.
Islam?
Islam.
Islam?
Islam.
All right. So, some of the information is that I was unable to bring the flyer. However, the information is, come ye all Asiatics. Come learn about your birthrights and your nationality. It's time for us that I'm saying to now to step up and represent. Because that's that time right now. We talk about the government, but we now need to start implementing the organic government right here amongst us. So on behalf of UMAR, which is the acronym for the United Moorish American Aboriginal Republic, as a representative of that entity, we invite all to come on out to this United Nations affair. And we're having it Thursday and Friday. Thursday, we're in the big building on the 13th floor from 2 p.m. all the way to 3:45. Friday is the big extravaganza. Make sure that you come in Indigenous attire. Represent, show yourselves. Don't come with a European suit or a Ku Klux Klan outfit. Come with some Moorish garb, wear your fez, proudly, a turban, something. Sisters, no tight clothes.
We don't need none of that. Dress modest. But we have that meeting on Friday. And Friday we're going to be meeting at 10 a.m. in front of the main building at the United Nations for a special tour inside of the United Nations. And we're also going to be having a special presentation being done by the United Nations Legal Affairs Department that will be discussing a special presentation with the Moors on treaty law and proclamations and declarations at the United Nations. We have a special tour, and the tickets for that tour, as well as that presentation, is going to be only $35. Unfortunately, I didn't have the, we have the tickets here, but we'll still be able to have them to be sold tomorrow. So I will leave my number, and I can give my number out before I leave. If anybody that's interested in obtaining their ticket, we can meet tomorrow, so you can pick up your ticket, and you may be able to, well, go into tomorrow, but you'll definitely be a part of Friday's event. All right? Tomorrow, anytime. I give you the number, we meet up.
What's the time again to meet?
Which one?
The time,
for
Thursday.
Oh, for Thursday. Thursday, if you already have to have registered in order to be in the United Nations, because the security is very, very tight. So, and you know, what's really, the really up and up on is that they have switched back on us with the timeliness with this event. Usually when we do the Indigenous Peoples Conference, it takes place in May. They moved it back and pushed it up in April. And then they put us over here with all these European holidays, or so-called holidays. So we got days off, it's a lot of switcheroo stuff. But nevertheless, nothing can stop us now. It's our time for the Moors to stand. Is that right? So this is why we're here. We're gonna be meeting Thursday for that brief session in the United Nations big building. But Friday, I would like everybody's concentration to come on out for that, because Friday's the big day. If you can stand the $35 for an individual or $50 for a family, then I'd encourage you to come on down. It's a learning experience. It's great for the family, you know, so that we don't just keep talking Moorish. They can actually see Moorish being worked. They can actually see their mothers and fathers sitting in the seats of government and doing, demonstrating what we're supposed to be doing. Islam?
Islam.
All right, so that's Friday. Friday we're gonna be meeting at 10 o'clock a.m. sharp. We'll be going inside of the building at 11, starting the tour at exactly 12. Okay, at about later on in that afternoon, we have a special presentation being done by the Legal Affairs Department. They're gonna be talking to us about the treaty laws, and then after that, we're going across the street to our very own Umar's panel on biodiversity. We'll be talking about the Moors' contributions to humanity, past, present, and the future, and also celebrating our indigenous Moorish bazaar. So everybody's free to come on out to that. Islam, peace. Thank you.
Brothers and sisters, I just want to also give the brother props, and also in reason, which brother Van Bobby? He's in Brazil? All right. Because the brother's been doing hard work in the background. You know, a lot of times he's in the front, but he's also in the background. So I want to give the brother acknowledgement for his hard work and making it possible for everybody to have a forum to deal with your affairs. Give him another hand.
We can start dispersing. It's wonderful to be together again, and we'll see you all next week, and it's fair on Friday.
Do we have a going out prayer?
Oh, yeah. Where's Brother Ali? You want to
get up? Let's do a prayer so that we can be cohesive in our travel. Brother.
All right.
Stand on the square. Five on the right, on the left, two on the right.
Repeat after me.
Allah, Father of the universe.
Allah, Father of the universe.
Father of love.
Father of love.
Truth.
Truth.
Peace.
Peace.
Freedom.
freedom,
and justice.
And justice.
Allah is my protector.
Allah is my protector.
My God.
My God.
And my salvation.
And my salvation.
By night.
By night.
And by day.
And by day.
Through his holy prophet.
Through his holy prophet.
Sheikh. Sharif.
Sharif.
Abdul.
Abdul.
Ali.
Ali.
Peace and love.
Peace and love.
That's the Free National Day for Noble Drew Ali.
You can't, as a Negro black, or color,
that's what he can do. In other words, like right now, like say for instance, like, say they got you hooked up, they got you jammed up downtown. Drew National.
Double take,
too.
All right.
How much
that one, brother? How you focus,
man? How you do what?
How you focus,
man? Right here. You have to move this. It takes you close and also.
Oh.
Yeah. And then to start, it started working?
Yeah.
Or it's working now? See the numbers counting down?
Yeah.
That means you got it working already.
Right.
How much that one?
And the power behind it, and for the people that are starting to come around to get serious about what this is, not just be trying to buy sovereignty through some package because you can't. It doesn't work that way. UCCs can't buy the sovereignty of the nation. That's just contracting. That's contracting under for color activity. But it is good to understand that contracting. Do you understand what I'm saying to you? But never allow that to confuse you with the sovereignty of the nation because it ain't there. Do you understand what I'm saying? That's unalienable. It can't be bought or sold. It's not transferable. But once you start commercing it, then what you do, you put your birthright into their jurisdiction. That's why they try to encourage people to try to buy their sovereignty through the UCCs. So that gives them a whole new platform of revenues, and you have just commercialized a right unalienable. Now it's in their jurisdiction because you're willing to contract it just so. That's why I tell people, don't try to get your birthright not through no UCCs. However, if you want to contract with them, understand the UCCs, but don't think that that's going to give you sovereignty. Sovereignty is not for sales. Once you commercialize it, you've given it up yourself. And then you claim to be in your proper person. They gonna screw you. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Oh, it's not a family.
I might have a question. My question about the voice system. It's more that I was trying to get
it. You wouldn't have got me this week because mainly when I'm at work, I don't get no signals. Do what I'm doing.
Speak up, brother, so we can get you.
No, this is a personal issue. Somebody has a private issue. I don't want to put it in there.
All right.
I don't know.
We the first one had the race.
He's talking privately. He don't want to be told.
Oh, all right. That's take it right. Down.
Yeah.
I like that.
And that's cool that she stood up at all.
had a good session. She had
just not being fair, or you don't understand the procedures, and like that, and yes, but no, you know, and being a natural person, and this is also why you don't allow them, or you object when they try to list you on their documents as pro se, when you come there in appropriate persona, because as Brother Jelani was saying, you know, they don't have any authority to deal with a natural person in the first place. Other deal of it is, just because they declared war against their citizens, you're not their citizens. And this is why you never allow them to put any documents before you saying that you're a U.S. citizen. So anything that they deal with you, they didn't have any documents, even if they got you under a kidnap, under arbitrary, etc. And anything they said, you're a U.S. citizen, you not only you say no, you say that's why you always ask the judge for under discovery any documents they have relative to you, so that you can take it to counsel of your choice, which is logical, and then review it. You know, you don't make any decisions on anything they place before you in that court. You wait on discovery, take it with you, then you go back to your counsel, just like right, take your brother's argument, and then when everybody's together, you have days where you come together with your legal affairs under Qazi or whoever may be assigned, etc. That would be your Aboriginal Indigenous law area. And that's when you would have your regular business meetings to deal with those matters. You're presented. And furthermore, the truth of the matter is when you organize, those documents would have already been there before you even went to the court.
Right.
And this is where we keep blowing it. We keep trying to claim the sovereignty as individuals.
Brother, I do have one question for the brother who played the role of defendant. And that question is, you kept saying for the record, on the record, that you were you. Okay.
By the way, that's enemy, trading with the enemies act. It started slowing the speed down a little bit, you know what I mean? And that's actually what Brother Colonel did. He was saying that constitutional rights is being violated, and that he's already notified the provost marshal, because I did through, you know, documentation, different things like that. You know what I mean? I actually got an email back from that department, not from the provost marshal, but I got an email back from, you know, there's a lot of specifics of how you even got to contact the right provost marshal, because they got provost marshal, but then there's provost marshal specifically for certain issues that's pertaining to constitutional rights violations, and they really slowed their speed up. They slowed it up.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
I was going to wait until after y'all ask the questions. But even in New York, dealing with the provost marshals, it's much harder. Because even with the sheriff, he's appointed. He's not elected here in New York. So I got to deal with that. And then I'm dealing with the provost marshal who's in the Army base.
Right.
And what's our Army base?
Fort Bragg.
Fort Hamilton.
Right.
Fort Hamilton Army base.
Right.
And he's very hard to get in touch with.
Right.
The provost marshal there. So how do I deal with that?
Let me mention again.
Here.
Now, I want to mention to all of you all again, just like we're here doing the mock, and just like people come here and they go to other classes to start getting concepts together, what you have to do with each other is get the people that you're involved with out of this concept of collecting documents and trying to buy sovereignty with the Uniform Commercial Codes, and get them to deal with the principle that all of these things ultimately must be litigated under, and that is international law principle. You understand? All right. You're under occupation. There are still rules of war that go on. The problem with it is you keep not acting like you're being warred against. And so you keep approaching them as if you're in a proper jurisdiction. And then, okay.
They say the United States citizen is an enemy of, you know, enemy of the country.
Okay, what would have happened, and would the whole adjudication have transpired if you had said, well, he kept asking for your name?
if you would have said, my appellation is, and then proceeded to give it, what would have happened at that point?
I'm just off experience. They'll ask, what is an appellation? I've heard them ask that. I've said, so, you know, some of them I just think are pretty dumb, or they're just very good actors, which, you know, depending on which way you want to go with it.
The reason being is because, remember, you are in a, you have a situation of diversity of state. They don't have the authority to have any record on you. They don't have an authority to attempt to identify you. You see what I'm saying? So why would you give them a nomin or an appellation so they can put it on the record and put it in all caps? Then I don't have to waste my breath to go, I am John, capital J, lowercase O, H, you know, now.
The thing about hearsay evidence, since this is a court of law, you're putting in evidence that they want to put on the record. Most people don't remember the name that they were given at the time of their birth. So that means that any name that you choose to accept is some hearsay. You don't remember the time or the date of your birth.
What is the date of birth?
Somebody comes along and tells you that that's the date that you were born, and this was the name that you were given. But your dog calls you Wolf, your cat calls you Meow. And when they're happy with you, they call you one thing. When they're not happy with you, they call you another. So you have many different appellations. It's only inanimate objects typically that have...
Can you waive that?
Huh?
Can't you waive it?
Can't you waive what?
Whatever fee or whatever...
You can do all of those different things. I'm just saying that a lot of what I've been seeing, my experience, because like I tell everybody from the beginning, you know, I do this every day off of experience. You can say and do whatever's necessary. You know what I mean? That you need to do to protect yourself legally based on the arguments you're making. But it's always going to come down to they got the guns right now in that position. That's just how I've been able to see it. You know what I mean? That's the bottom line of it. Now, because you're in a war type situation, you know, well, it's not type of situation, it's actually a war. It's about countering. Just like in any fight, in boxing, there's a counter for every punch. You gotta duck, throw another punch. You know what I mean? You gotta plan and strategize to see how you're gonna attack the enemy. You know what I mean? So the strategy is very important in any kind of legal situation. You know, you hear attorneys and all that get together and talk about how they wanna prepare some kind of legal strategy.
Brother Sahib, you just mentioned a great point about putting the lien against the municipality. I believe you're talking about either a warranty lien or a mechanics lien, if I'm not mistaken.
Right.
I know there's a common law lien, you can do that also. Mm-hmm. That's a beautiful tactic in that when you put that lien against that municipality, they now can issue bonds, get credit, and get financing with respect to the municipality. So you literally are shutting down business at that point. Okay? And then the only way that can be exhausted and released is by the individual with that lien. So you really have to deal with the matter at that point, and you really are affecting them in the peace.
But that also has to be done properly.
Right, it has to be done properly. But it also is just one of the different things you should focus on other than, you know, really utilizing. When you're dealing with, like Brother Ty was saying, when you're dealing with the municipals, when you say the Constitution, that really gets them, they get alert then. They really do. I don't care what it is, what kind of situation. If you say something about my constitutional rights are being violated, you put that on the record.
And else. My name. Not living natural being.
And a date of birth is a legal term. Are you qualified to give a legal opinion? Do you even know what a date of birth is? Like you said, it's hearsay.
Right.
We were looking for Title 18, 241, 242. David found USC Title 42. The problem with that is that it deals with civil rights. And by that, we don't want civil rights. 242. Every person who under color, that's 240. That's 42. No, that's civil rights.
Right. Keep coming down. Title 18.
Oh, all right. Here we go.
Here
it
is.
All right, now, see this arrow right there? That title,
thank you. I didn't see her. You see Tarik being crying. 241, this arrow is how you narrow down to be. It's two or more persons. We want to really, really emphasize this.
I'm going to read what these titles are because a lot of people do not know, and I know you don't, that this exists, and it is Title 18 that you utilize back to the courts or to anyone in the court officer that they can be, that they are violating and they can be sued for it. And it's, here's what it says.
Under Title 18 of the United States Code, which covers crimes and criminal procedures, under Section 241, Conspiracy Against Rights of Citizens, it states, if two or more persons conspire to injure, oppress, threaten, or intimidate any citizen in the free exercise or enjoyment of any right or privilege secured to him by the Constitution or laws of the United States, or because of